All right, how's everybody doing? Thank you, thank you. So everybody can hear me fine? Okay, great. Before I start, I'd just like to thank some people, some organizations that made this happen. So first, definitely would like to thank Father Peter. Thank you for, looking over this university. I remember growing up in Philly, Villanova is always one of those places that that you know is iconic for people from Philadelphia. So thank you. Also want to thank Hezekiah Lewis, Professor Lewis, for being a good friend and also for what he does here. I want to thank the Department of Peace and Justice, Carol Anthony, Catherine, everyone who's been involved in making this happen, all the different organizations. And so thank you. I also want to thank, special thanks to Tony Chenault, who, yeah, let's give him a round of applause. I don't have to tell you how great he is. You already know how great he is. So I want to shout out him, and I also want to give a shout out to Alan Hammond back there, who's at the merch table, who's a good friend of mine and also cousin to Tony Chenault. So thank you all for having me. I'm going to obviously be reflecting on the legacy of MLK tonight and talking a little bit about my story. My book is called Buck. It's a memoir, Young Buck, Buck Wild, Buck Shots, Buck Town, Slave Buck, Black Buck, Make Buck, Buck Now. I find myself feeling as if I'm touching the ground and the ceiling in schools that don't engage in healing. Nah, these schools just open the wounds and entrap me in rooms where I am consumed by hypocrisy. But hold up. Even Greek philosophers weren't the authors of their own philosophies. Oh, shit. And the statues on campus be watching me. Washington, Jefferson, Williams clocking me as if to say my time's up. But I don't run laps on tracks. Nah, I run laps around the scholars of tomorrow because their new schools of thought are merely our histories borrowed, and they label me militant and black national radical. Yo, they tried to put my learning process on sabbatical. But I don't apologize. I spit truth into those eyes that have been infected by those lies. Then they try to get me to see their point of view from a cat that looked like me, but he don't walk like me, talk like me, or act like me. And homie started running when I asked if he was black like me. Mastering their thoughts and forgetting our own. And you wonder why we always feel alone. From the media to academia, hanging brothers like coats. That's why in they schools, I take two sets of notes. One set to ace the test, and the other set I call the truth. And when I find historical contradictions, I use that first set as proof. Proof that black youth's minds are being polluted, convoluted, diluted, not culturally rooted in anything except the Western massacre. That's why when I was in school, me and my friends, we were scared of Africa. We viewed our mother's land through the racist of eyes like David Hume and Immanuel Kant, not knowing Immanuel Kant tell me nothing about a land he's never seen, a land rich with history, beautiful kings and queens. But they had us believe otherwise. The history they taught built on high-rise lies. They didn't teach us that the pyramids were completed before Greece and Rome were conceptualized. Then they try to claim the Egyptians' race was a mystery, and I used to believe them until I went to Egypt and read Herodotus' book 2 of the histories. Can it be any clearer? Students, look in the mirror. You are a reflection of divinity. Don't let them fool you with selective memory. Walk high. Listen to the elders who spoke. Black students, brown students, always take two sets of notes. Thank you. So two sets of notes, that's like my philosophy on life. you probably got to take more than two, for real. but at least two, you know what I'm saying? Because they taught me in school that Christopher Columbus discovered America. Didn't they teach you that? Yeah, that's what they taught me. So I remember one day, you know, I had an item that belonged to the teacher. She said, that's mine. I said, no, I discovered it. we got to challenge things. That's what two sets of notes is about. I'll come back to talk about what Buck is really about, but that's what it's about. It's about not just believing that or not just accepting that, especially when these things that they teach sometimes contradict who we are, or contradict the reality, contradict the truth, right? And so that's one of my mantras in life, is this notion of two sets of notes. And I want to talk about the origins of where that came from. I remember I was, you know, I'm from Philadelphia, uptown, and so I remember I went up to this prison, way out Camp Hill, and I remember, you know, I went up to this prison, and I was younger, and I was meeting with a whole bunch of young guys. You know, I've been to all these countries and all these universities. Some of the most impactful, transformative moments that I've ever experienced have happened in, you know, prisons and jails and things like that. And so I was in this jail in Camp Hill, and I did this writing workshop with these brothers. And it was real special because, you know, we hear so many negative things about people who are incarcerated. And I was just actually talking to a professor about the, you know, the incarceration situation in America and in this, even in this state. And so, but these brothers were brilliant. I was teaching creative writing. And I mean, you know, they were on another level. But there was one dude in particular that was just such an amazing writer. His voice, his power, his eloquence, everything was just like jumping off the page. And so when we were done the workshop, I was allowed to go see, you know, where they actually spent their days and nights. I was actually allowed to see their cells. And so I remember walking down the cell block, and when I got to Jordan's cell, that was the exceptional writer. I remember when I got to his cell looked really different than everybody else's cell. And I couldn't figure out why. Like, it just looked different, though, like straight off the bat. So I did a double take. I did a triple take. what's it called if you do it four times? Huh? I did that. So I did that four times, and then I finally realized what was going on with his cell, and what made it so different. And then I got enraged. He didn't have a bed. So, you know, here's the smartest, most intelligent, eloquent brother in this prison, and then here they are dehumanizing him, not giving him a place to lay his head. So I get pissed. And I'm like, yo, you want me to go, you know what I mean? You want me to, you know what I mean? I'm getting my Philly, you know what I mean? My Philly jump. I'm ready, you know what I mean? So I'm like, yo, you want me to talk to somebody? You know, you want me to, this is an injustice. I'm pissed. And he starts laughing at me. And he's like, yo, man, it's cool, it's cool. He's like, I got a bed, man. And he goes underneath his bunk, and he shows me that, hey, he has this little mattress. He's like, I got this mattress, man. I'm cool. And I'm like, oh, okay. He's like, I don't sleep on it, though. I'm like, so what do you sleep on? He's like, I sleep on the floor. He's like, I sleep against the wall. He's like, I sleep on the steel frame. Anything, but not on the bed. So now I'm like mad confused. Like, why you got beef with the bed? Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, I don't get it. And, you know, he gets real serious. His body gets tense, eyes filled with disquiet. And he comes up to me and he's like, MK, I don't sleep on that bed because I can't trust comfort in a place like this. He said, comfort in here numbs you to the reality of where you really are and why. And so for Jordan, sleeping on the floor against the steel frame, all of that reminded him in that raspy voice of reality where he really was and why. And it helped him keep his mind, as Dr. King used to say, and they used to say in this freedom song, it helped keep his mind stayed on freedom. Right, so his mind was focused, right? And so I thought a lot about that, a lot about this notion of how he kept his mind stayed on freedom by not being comfortable, by almost forcing himself. I mean, he's already in jail, which is an uncomfortable place, but he's forcing himself to be even more uncomfortable so that he can be focused, right? He doesn't want to enjoy any comforts while he's in there, right? I thought about that idea and that concept and just what that meant. And for me, it gave me a lot of personal inspiration as an artist, because I feel like that's the purpose of art. The purpose of art is to remove that mattress from underneath you. You know what I'm saying? So when I say live from the flames of Baltimore, what you call this, you don't call it war. Tanks in my hood, no aquarium. No thanks, Nat God ain't scared of them. Buzz cuts and Humvees hunt me bluntly, cause I be the color of blunt leaves. Leaving streets redder than month leaves. Black life, we on that month to month lease. So we burn this ish. Wake up, shoot a scene like I'm earning. So anyway, But that's the purpose of art, right? To wake you up, let you know what's going on, you know? Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, learn how to play ball with a hanger. They used to cut your balls off when they hang you. Balls like these so rare they endangered. So that's the purpose of art, right? Wake people up. Let them know what's going on in the world. You know what I'm saying? And so I thought a lot about that, that whole idea of removing that mattress. And then I thought about, well, what do you do once for an artist once that mattress is removed? And then, again, that got my mind going. And I came up with another mantra that's really been influential in my life. Throughout my life, throughout my career, this mantra of you make an observation, you got an obligation. Observation, obligation. Transforming observations into obligations, you know? When I talk about the Dream Remix and I talk about Dr. King and I think about that legacy, I mean, that's someone who gave us a tremendous example of how to transform observations into obligations. And I've been greatly inspired by that, not by just Dr. King, but throughout the history. And when I say two sets of notes, too, you know, that applies to Dr. King. Don't let the post office define who Dr. King is for you. You know what I'm saying? You know, don't let them appropriate his image and make you think he was somebody that he wasn't. You know what I mean? Always take two sets of notes. But anyway, back to this notion of observation obligation, right? I started thinking about that. How do I transform observations into obligations? How do I transform what I see into something that I can help solve, right? All of these issues and all of these things. And so that became my personal mantra, observation obligation. And I got inspired looking at my history, looking at our history. It's a collective history. Black history ain't just my history. It's all of our history. It's American history. It's world history. So I got inspired looking at it. I got inspired looking at people like Harriet Tubman, one of the first people in this, you know, that transformed these observations into obligations. Her observation was what? That her people weren't free. They were in bondage. So she risked her life, her livelihood, everything to get her people free. And you know what Harriet Tubman said that I used to love? She said, I freed 1,000 slaves, but I could have freed 10,000 if only they knew they were slaves. Ain't that deep? I mean, you know, I mean, it's so deep to how can you not know that you're a slave? You know what I mean? How is that possible? But I mean, how is it possible what's going on right now, right? The prison industrial. How is it possible that we have more people in prison in America than any country, any point in history ever in the history of the world? How is it possible that we're just warehousing the poor? How is this possible, right? So anyway, Harriet Tubman transformed observations into obligations. I'm inspired as a filmmaker. I know Hezekiah here is teaching film. I know there's some filmmakers in here. Shout out to Myra on the camera, right? From filmmakers in here. I'm inspired by Oscar Michaud, right? Oscar Michaud made an observation, right? In the early 20th century. His observation was that there was this new thing called motion pictures, where they could take 24 pictures in 1 second, make it look like it's moving. And it was a big deal, right? That this thing was going to change the world. And it was changing the world. But his observation was that every motion picture that was created, all of the early motion pictures, go back and look at them, all make black people look subhuman. All are derogatory. All are denigrating to who we are, to our spirit, our character. So here's this powerful medium that's only being used to denigrate and degrade black folks. Only being used, right, as a way to justify the public policy of Jim Crow, justify the public policy of racism. Because that's what art does, right? Art is not just art. That's why when people say, like, oh, is this just art? It's just art. It's just a song. Nah. That justifies the public policy. They were able to justify those things because of the ideas that people had about black people. Where did they get those ideas from? They got those ideas from media, from books, from cartoons, from movies, from all of these motion pictures, any medium, right? And so Oscar Michaud recognized this. And he didn't just, you know, tweet about it. Well, they didn't have Twitter back then, of course. But if they did have Twitter, he wouldn't have just tweeted about it. You know what I'm saying? He wouldn't have been on the Twitter finger joint. What he would have done is he would have made films, and that's what he did. Oscar Michaud made like 45 films in the span of like 20 years. So whenever it's getting rough, you know, and I'm having a hard time on a film, and I'm struggling, I think about Oscar Michaud, right? Because here's a man that made, you know, we're talking about between 1919 and 1940, making 45 films. Think about what it was like for a black man, a black woman, anybody of color during that time. You can't even ride the bus or do any, walk down the street, yeah, let alone make a film, make a movie. And not only make a movie, he wrote the books, then he adapted, because, you know, all these industries were not created, and if they were there, they weren't there for black folks. So Oscar Michaud wrote his books, distributed his own books, went door to door, right? Got enough money from his books, built his own movie studio, got black actors from Chicago, drove them to Idaho where his studio was, and started making these black films. And then, of course, white mainstream distributors didn't want to distribute the films. So what do you think he did? He distributed himself. He said, I don't need y'all. and that's the spirit. So Oscar Michaud is a transformer, somebody that transformed observations into obligations. Ida B. Wells. Ida B. Wells observed that her people were swinging from southern trees like strange fruit. Blood on the leaves, blood on the root. So her obligation was to take the pen and to speak truth, to write truth to power. And that's what she did, Ida B. Wells. Paul Robeson, who actually got his debut in an Oscar Michaud film, right? Body and Soul. Paul Robeson, here you have a young man from, you know, whose both his parents were enslaved. Imagine that, both your parents are enslaved. Both your parents are enslaved and you become an actor, world famous, a lawyer. Let's not act like he wasn't an academic, right? A lawyer, a poet, a scholar, an activist. You speak 19 languages. And your parents were enslaved, you know what I mean? And notice I always talk about the enslaved and not slaves, right? But his parents were enslaved, right? And so Paul Robeson is one of the people that inspired an early transformer. And Robeson's thing was, look, the purpose of art isn't to just show the world as it is, but as it could and should be. And so that's what Robeson did. He used his art to show the world how it could be, how it should be. And he, you know, sung in like 20 something languages for peace, for justice. You know, that was Paul Robeson. Of course, we're celebrating Dr. King tonight, and he was someone who made a tremendous transformation in terms of recognizing observations and transforming them into obligations, right? Not just by speaking, but by organizing, right? Not just by organizing, but by writing. Right? Not just by writing, but by showing up and being there and spreading love to the people. One of the things that I love that Dr. King said was that I can't be who I ought to be until you are who you ought to be. He talked about this labyrinth of interconnectivity. I can't do me unless you do you. We can't truly fully be who we are, right, until you are truly and fully who you are. I was born in Zimbabwe. That's why my middle name is actually, you ready? Milo. You gonna say it with me? Milo. Hey! Did it pretty good. So I was born in Zimbabwe in southern Africa, and there's a really interesting story behind that, but I was born in southern Africa, and because my parents are not from southern Africa, so that's why it's interesting. But I was there, and we have a concept in Zimbabwe and in South Africa called Ubuntu, which is very similar to Dr. King's concept of this labyrinth of interconnectivity. But Ubuntu says, I am because we are, right? That a person is a person because of other people, and that you can't really be who you ought to be unless other people can be who they ought to be. And so that's why fighting for your freedom is important to me, right? James Baldwin said, they come for you during the day, they're coming for me at night. So we're all connected and we're all in this. So that's part of my inspiration and part of my inspiration to try to transform observations into obligations. I'm also inspired by people like Paulo Freire. I mean, you guys are here in school, and Freire said, the Brazilian educator, he said the purpose of your education is either one of two things, to either transform the world or to maintain the status quo. And we know what the status quo is. We were born into all this bullshit, war and poverty and all this disgust. And so Frere said, the purpose of your education, why are you here? To just maintain this or to transform it? You know? And so that's someone who inspires me. As an artist, I just want to kind of end with a couple things I want to say. There's so much I want to say. I wrote this book called Buck. It's a memoir. Young Buck, Buck Wild, Buck Shots, Buck Town, Slave Buck, Black Buck, Make Buck, Buck Now. It's about growing up in Philadelphia. It's about a side of Philadelphia that many of you will never see unless you open your eyes, you know? It's about a city that I love. It's about so much of the issues that are present in our city, right? I tried to infuse a lot of that in there because that's a lot of my upbringing. It's a coming of age story. But it also talks about me discovering my love for writing and wanting to become a writer and kind of finding my purpose in life. I talk about the blank page a lot, right? Blank page saved me. America enraged me. Then that trick paved me. New slaves, old slavery. My grandma told me streets far from holy. Now I'm lonely. My homies' bodies is holy. So Buck talks about that experience. But Buck also talks about, like I said, me discovering writing, reading, and what that did to me, how that changed me. I remember I got kicked out of every school that I went to coming up in Philly. Any of my old teachers here? Good. No, it's actually not good. I wish they were here. You know what I mean? Seriously. Because I was one of the young black boys that they gave up on and said it wasn't going to be anything. So I wish they were here so I could, you know, say what up. But you know, one of the things that I wanted to talk about was just me the power of language and the power of literature and the importance of it. I remember I had an epiphany, you know, going to school, getting kicked out of different schools, just kind of being lost. School for a long time didn't really appeal to me. It was just rote memorization, regurgitation, and you know, the two sets of notes. I wasn't taking any sets, so it was no notes, zero sets of notes. And it, you know, it wasn't working out. But I remember when I first started writing, this teacher put a blank page in front of us and told the class to write. And so first thing I wrote was Buck School without the B, you know what I'm saying? And she said, good, keep writing. And I remember being stuck, like, wow, what am I gonna say now? And it got very, like, scary for me. And I want to actually read to you a little bit from that moment and talk about, you know, connect this to kind of a bigger issue here. Hold on a second. So I turn the page over and it's blank again. The blank page is a starter pistol that fires and triggers my mind to sprint. What will I write? What will I say? Will I say what I write? Write what I say? Something funny? Something serious? Something about my family? Amir? Ryan? How will I start? Whose story will I tell? My story? Something made up? What about a story about a boy from Philly? A lost boy who wants to find himself but doesn't know where to look. Who wants to tell his story but doesn't know where to begin or end. Who searches anyway and discovers something about himself, about the world. I stare at the blank page, an ocean of white alive with possibility. I hear myself take a breath, then exhale deep like I just rose from underwater. It's like I'm at the free throw line again, foul shots, like the game is on the line again. I remember something my pops told me, shoot to make it. My hand's shaking now, trembling like it's freezing. Then it hits me, a silence louder than all the music I've ever heard in my life. All the light in the world in one beam before me. I grip the pen, and something shoots down my spine, sits me straight up. The pen feels heavy, like it's made of stone. At exactly which point do you start to realize that life without knowledge is death in disguise? I stare deep into the blank page and see myself. I feel something I've never felt before, purpose. I don't know what my exact purpose is yet, but I know it has something to do with this pen and this blank page. I am a blank page. Holding the pen this way, snug and firm in my fist, makes me feel like I can write my future, like I can spell my destiny in sharp strokes. The blank page begs me to tell a story, dares me to tell one that's never been told before, and to tell it like it will never be told again. The blank page opens up a room in my heart that I didn't even know existed. It opens a dream that I didn't know was there. So that's a little bit from the moment that I discovered the blank page. But right after I discovered the blank page, I discovered reading. You know, before then I wasn't a reader. And I had another epiphany when I was about 16, 17. And I said, oh, now I see why reading was illegal for black people during slavery. Because I'd always heard that, you know, back in the day, the old folks tell you things like, you know, back in the day, it used to be illegal, you know, and they're trying to get you to read, and it's like you're young and you're just kind of in one ear out of the other. So I always heard that growing up. Back in the day, it was illegal for, you know, but I never really thought about what that meant until I was in a jail cell, right? And I really started to think about that, like, man, back in the day, we could be in jail somewhere, right? And you could see me like, yo, MK, what you in here for? Yo, I was on like chapter 9, man. They just, you know what I'm saying? Like, yo, you got booked for a book? Like, you really could get booked for a book back in the day. You know, you riding in the car, you know, group of black guys, you got books on you, you know what I'm saying? Yo, got hide the books and you put the books in your butt crack and all that, you know what I'm saying? And somebody got to read that one day. But, you know, you think about that. I mean, you think about the severity of it. It's so funny, but it is so crazy. I could literally get locked up for a book. Like, yo, tell my mom, you know what I mean? Like, really getting booked, like, for this. So, that made me wonder, like, wow, what's the deal with it, right? And that's when I think I realized that, you know, I sub-vocalize, we sub-vocalize. We think in words, you know? And so words are so important. If you limit someone's vocabulary, you're not just limiting their vocabulary, you're limiting their thoughts, right? Can't even conceive of freedom because you might not have the language to get there. And so language became very important for me, and that's why I deal with words, because language helps me design my own reality. And so that was important for me, and an important part of the book, an important part of my journey. And, you know, to kind of take it back to observation obligation, I've used that voice and that blank piece of paper to transform those observations into obligations, to use my voice as a voice for the voiceless, to say things that, you know, I know back in Germantown or Alney or North Philly or West Philly or whatever, all the people that I grew up with might not have a chance to say. I want to say it for them. And I also understand that I'm rooted in that tradition, right? As an artist, and I'll leave you with this, there's four things that I'm inspired by that are rooted in this African-American tradition. And I would say the tradition of quilt making. You guys ever seen the African-American quilts from back in the day? Yeah, from during the slave days and all that? You know, they had these quilts that were really amazing. And there's four things that I take away from those African-American quilts that were made by black women who were enslaved. The first thing is the quilts were incredibly resourceful. So they were able to make something out of nothing. I call that the maximization of minimal resources, right? They were able to take very little and just make it, you know, make it happen. Now, you know, if you got a black grandma or somebody, like, you know that they do that all the time, right? You know, that's how my grandma was. She's always making something out of, I didn't even know we had that, you know? And so there's that tradition of resourcefulness, right? And I try to bring that into my art, always being resourceful, always trying to, you know, maximize minimal resources, maximize whatever we have, you know? And a lot of times that creates more creativity. But the second thing is also, you know, they paid attention, when you look at those quilts, they paid very close attention to, you know, the beauty and the aesthetic qualities of them. So these are beautiful quilts. Even though they didn't have a lot, they made them beautiful, colorful, vibrant. And so that's important for me as an artist. It's not only important to be resourceful, but you also have to master your craft and you have to be good at the art, right? And so that's something that inspires me. The third thing the quilts did that are very inspirational is they were practical. They weren't made to just hang on a wall. These quilts could keep you warm, right? And so here are these black women who were enslaved that made these, you know, quilts that were resourceful, beautiful, practical. What else? The quilts, this is the deep part, they would, remember these women were enslaved, they would embed these symbols into the quilts. And if you weren't hip, you might just look at it like a symbol. Oh, that's a cool quilt. But if you were hip, you would realize that that's not just a cool quilt. That's actually a map to show you how to get to the nearest safe house along the Underground Railroad so that you can get free. So here's, yes. So these coded language, right? Coded symbols, right? So here's a piece of art made by these enslaved women that is resourceful, right? That is beautiful, right? That is practical, right? And that's also emancipatory. It can actually get you free. A piece of art can get you free. You know what I'm saying? That's deep. And so that's what I'm that's the tradition that I'm inspired by. They transform those observations into obligations and use it in their art. There's an old saying, you know, when I look at what's going on right now in the world, you know, sometimes I'm super depressed about it. Sometimes I'm optimistic a little bit. Sometimes I'm hopeful. But I go through different stages, you know. But there's this old preacher's tale where they talk about this woman named Miss Sally. And these kids come to Miss Sally one day and they say, "We have a bird in our hand. Is it dead or alive?" And Miss Sally is blind, so she can't see. But she has vision. So that's why people come to her, right? Sight and vision. So she says, "Well, children, I don't know if the bird is dead or alive. There's only one thing I know." And the children are like, "What's that?" And she's like, "It's in your hands." When I think about, you know, this generation and the legacy of Dr. King, and, you know, they say if we stand tall, it's only because we stand on the shoulders of giants or those who came before us. When I think about the legacy of Dr. King, the legacy of the Civil Rights Movement, the Black Liberation Movement, when I think about the legacy of all these things, and I wonder, is this generation going to hold those things and build on them, build on that progress, or are we going to just let it subside and kind of go back, you know, and regress? When I think about that, I think about that bird story, you know. I don't know the answer. I don't know what we're going to do, this generation, our generation. The only thing I know is that it's in our hands. Thank you. And we're going to... Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. And now we have some time for Q&A. I'll also be signing books back there and T-shirts and stuff like that. So Q&A, questions, comments, thoughts? Anybody want to go first? Yes. Thank you.
Great speech. Of course, we know each other. We're both from the same neighborhood. Just want to commend you on all your success you had. But can you talk about the process of getting to that success? Like, when you first started off graduating from UCLA, did you know exactly, did you want to be a writer, a filmmaker? Like, how did you define your exact expertise?
That's a great question. I think in a lot of ways, the things grew organically. And when I say organically, it just organically, man. I remember when I was in college, first of all, my advice to you, for those of you who are in college or undergrad, grad school, whatever you're in, my advice to you is to be working on, if you do know what it is that you're interested in, to be working on that now. You know, sometimes people think, well, once I get out of school, then that's when I'm going to start my life or my career or whatever. And I don't really see why you have to wait till you get out of school. I feel like, you have a lot of time on your hands, usually, around this time. Not everybody. But, you know, I feel like, put it this way, you'll never have more time. You know what I'm saying? You might not have a lot, but shit ain't going to get any easier. So while you have this time, you know, utilize it. And so that's one of the things that I tried to do, is to utilize the time that I was in school and to make projects and stuff. And I think I remember when I wrote my first book, I was in the projects in the Bronx with my cousin. And he said, "Yo, I heard you got a book." He said, "I heard you got a book, son." You know, that's how he talk. "Heard you got a book, son." I said, You know, doing a little something. He said, "I don't know why the hood don't read." And I remember that stuck with me, like, wow. that just brought me all the way down. You know what I mean? Like, I thought I was doing something here. And he's like, nah, the hood don't read. And that made me think. And so there's two things that happened with that. One thing is I began to think in languages. I talked about language a minute ago, but I began to think in artistic languages, meaning if I write a book, maybe you understand the language of literature. Maybe you don't. So what about if I make a song? You understand the language of hip-hop? You know, okay, if you don't understand that language, what about if I make a film? These are all, I started seeing all these things as languages. Cinema's a language, music's a language, literature's a language, poetry's a language, visual art is a language. So I wanted to be like Paul Robeson, I wanted to be multilingual. I want to be able to communicate with you however you want it, you know what I'm saying? However you want it, I wanted to be able to deliver that. So that's what got me into filmmaking and music and other things, because it's like, okay, well, how do I want to, and then remember, for those of you who speak more than one language, once you learn more than one language, it actually increases your ability to learn more languages, right? And so once you learn, you know, once you're already doing film and you're doing writing, and it's easier to get into music, right? It's easier to adapt a new language because, you know, there's connection, there's patterns and connections that you can see. So that's a part of it. The other thing I realized is that my cousin was absolutely wrong, you know? The hood does read, you know? That's why my book has been on the bestseller list. It's not the suburbs, it's the hood. You know what I'm saying? So the hood does read, but how many books are written for them? You know what I'm saying? When I meet a kid that doesn't like to read in the hood, I just feel like he hasn't got the right book yet. That's all it is. You keep giving them, you know, Huck Finn or whatever you're giving him, and he's not feeling it. You know what I'm saying? It's not relating. But give him Buck and see what happens. You know what I mean? It's literally, I've been in the schools and the prisons all throughout this country, and I've seen all of these young readers who people thought before were not readers, but these are voracious readers. But they're waiting for the right books. You're not giving them the right material. So that's, you know, that's what kind of got me into doing it. So it was organic. I didn't have it all planned out. I feel like it's like, you know, you're driving to wherever you're driving to. Let's say Baltimore. You can't see Baltimore from Philly. You know, you just can't physically see it. If you're in your car, you can only see maybe a couple hundred feet in front of you. But you get to that couple hundred feet, and then you can see another couple hundred feet. You get to that couple, there's another couple hundred feet. You get the point. And then by the time, oh, shit, I'm in Baltimore. You know what I'm saying? And, like, that's, like, kind of how it goes, right? I didn't see all the way to Baltimore, you know? I only saw maybe 1,000 feet in front. And then once, but I was focused on that 1,000 feet, make sure I don't crash, make sure I don't veer. Then once I got to that 1,000 feet, oh, I can see more now. You know what I mean? And then eventually you see, and then you see a city, and then you realize there's something beyond Baltimore. There's a whole world out here. And that's kind of, I feel like, what my, you know, a metaphor for my journey. Yeah. All right, what else? Other questions? Yeah.
What's up, homie?
Hey, what's up?
Staying with the theme of obligation, observation, obligation, as I guess this, speaking to the Villanova community, what are the things that we should observe or should be observing that we need to turn into obligation?
Okay.
From your perspective.
I don't know what's happening on this particular campus, but it is a college campus in America. You know what I mean? My friend is coming out with a book called Blackballed. You guys heard about this book? Called Blackball. It's about racism on college campuses in America. It's serious, you know? And so that's one thing is, you know, when I talk about young buck, buck wild, buck shots, bucktown, say buck, black buck, make buck, buck now. I'm talking about young buck, that's me. That's all my young bucks in the city, different cities all across America. Buck wild, that's what I was, going wild, going crazy. Buck shots, that's Killadel, Pennsylvania. Bucktown, that's hip hop. Slave buck, black buck, that's the racism that I was born into, you know, the racism that in 1526, when the first Africans were brought here, you know what I mean, that they were, you know, subjected to in 1619 when the other, and so that's the racism of the past. But when I say slave buck, black buck, I ain't talking about the past, I'm talking about my experience. Buck in Philly. I was in Philly the other day. You won't believe this. I was in Philly at the car wash the other day, South Philly. I told someone the other day, I said, yo, I love Philly. It's a great city. But don't get it twisted. It's up north, right? Oh, no, what do they call it? Up south, not up north. That's kind of redundant. But up south, you know what I'm saying? It's up south, meaning that we in Philly, but goddamn, am I in Mississippi? What did Nina Simone say? Mississippi, goddamn. That's what Nina Simone said, and I felt like that the other day. I'm in South Philly. I just want a car wash. That's all, you know. Can I be clean? So I pull up to the car wash. I get out the car. It's one of those ones that you get out the car and then, you know. So I get out the car and go up to the car wash. I'm ready to pay. Nice African brother behind the counter. So I get ready to pay, put my money out, and I see a big Confederate flag hat right behind him, like for sale. They were selling a bunch of them. So I kind of put my wallet on hold, and I said, yo, man, what's that? And he said, you know, what? And I said, that. And he turned around, and he said, oh, it's just a hat. I said, no, that's not just a hat. That's a symbol of hate, man. Like, we're in Philly. You know what I'm saying? Like, what? Like, I have a house in North Carolina. Maybe I could understand down there. I kind of expect that shit when I go down there. But I'm in Philadelphia, my city that I was raised in. You know what I'm saying? That I identify with. I'm in Philly. I don't expect that. And so I told him, I said, take it down. He said, no, I can't take it down. The owner won't let me do that. I said, well, I'm not paying. He said, well, I said, look, take it down, man. I said, just take it down when I make my sale, and then you can do whatever you want. You know what I'm saying? I said, I just can't give you the money feeling with the thing. Like, that's just not going to happen. So he wouldn't take it down. And so when my car came out the joint, you already know what I did. I just jumped in my car and left. I didn't pay, but it bothered me so much. The other thing I did, I videotaped it on my phone, the whole experience, just in case they try to come after me, you know what I mean? But, you know, I say, look, man, I'll put y'all on YouTube or something. But the thing is, you know, so we talk about observations, man. Like, we don't even have to. A lot of times we're like, oh, we got to go to Ferguson. We got to go. No. Go to, right, first of all, right here. Right here. It's right here. You know what I'm saying? And I don't have to, you know, I don't have to be, have to go to this college to know. I went to Lafayette College. I've been to school. I went to UCLA. I've been to hundreds of college campuses. It's the same on every college campus, because unless we address it and deal with it, you know, then it doesn't get addressed. You know, like, for example, I want to make sure a white person ask a question in here tonight. A lot of times you do these events, it's a whole white audience, and only like the two black people who are in the room are the only ones to ask a question. It's like, damn, racism isn't a black problem. Do you understand that? Black people didn't come over here racist. We're not the problem. You get it, right? Yeah, so a lot of times, too, white people ask me, like, well, what can, you know, how can I help the black community? No, your community is making the laws and enforcing the policies that are racist. You guys got to talk to each other. You can't come in the hood, go in the suburbs and figure that shit out, man. I'm serious. It's so funny, but it's so real. Y'all know it, right? You have to know this. And if you don't, let's talk about it. What else? Yeah. And diversity, I love it. Yes. What's up? Thank you. I love it. Hey, what's up, man?
Hi. Thank you very much for the speech today, Professor.
Thank you.
And I'm sorry to disappoint you. I'm not white, but
you didn't disappoint me at all, man.
I'm actually from China, but I do care about the issue you talk about today.
Thank you.
And we actually read the book in my English class.
Oh,
and I'm not a student from Villanova University.
Oh.
I'm a student in the local high school, Shipley School.
Oh.
And today I came here with my English teachers and my
hey.
Peers. So,
yeah. Nice to meet you, man.
Nice to meet you.
Yeah.
Thank you. And I'm very honored to get this chance to ask you this question. You know, like yesterday was the was Dr. Martin Luther King's Day. And we all know that Dr. Martin Luther King is the leader in the civil rights movement. And today, you are one of the many leaders in the African-American communities. So I'm just wondering, like, what would you do similarly or differently in today's world to further his efforts and to in adaption to today's time and changes? Thank you.
Great question.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. That's a great question. And thank you to the Shipley School and everybody who came out from the Shipley School. That's great to see high schools out here and reading the book. That's important. That's a great question. You know, that's why I call this the Dream Remix, because I feel like, you know, a lot of times we get caught up in, like, the nostalgia of the past, and we romanticize the past in ways which sometimes are good. But my thing is that it's going to look a lot different today, you know? Civil rights today, the movement today, everything looks a lot different. And so we don't, I try not to get stuck into a mode of, like, what it would look like back then and think about what it would look like today. Now, for me personally, I'm an artist. And I would go so far to call myself an artivist. An artivist, one who uses art as a way and as a, you know, really, it's like, if you guys are going to be out there, you know, marching, right? It's like, I want to provide the soundtrack. You know what I'm saying? If you guys are going to be out there teaching, you guys are going to be out there, I want to help document and tell the stories, you know? So for me as an artist, you know, I feel like my role is to be that voice for the voiceless. My role is to document. My role is to make art that makes us think, that challenges the status quo, that provokes thought, you know? So that's kind of how I feel my role is, you know, in terms of being an artist and an artivist, you know, which in a lot of ways subverts the dominant paradigm. You know, that's what art is doing in a lot of ways. You know, art is very political. Art is either supporting the status quo or it's, you know, transforming it or somehow going against it. And that's what I try to make art to do. So I think that's one of the things. But I think, you know, Dr. King was like, people talk about nonviolence. And a lot of times they talk about it in a way that's like, almost like he was soft, you know? But they don't understand how gangster it is to be nonviolent in the face of evil and chaos, you know? So I applaud that about Dr. King, and that's something that I honestly don't know if I would be that strong, you know, that gangster to be nonviolent in the face of that kind of violence, you know. So I don't know if I'm, I always kind of been conflicted about that one, because, you know, Malcolm X, sometimes people like to contrast Malcolm and Martin. Malcolm said, can't ever reach a man if you don't speak his language. And so Malcolm was talking about language, and he just said, you know, when the Klan comes to us speaking their language, you know, the language of violence or guns, or the, you know, then we need to be able to speak that language too, so that they can understand us too, where we're coming from. And so it's interesting. It's an interesting debate. I go back and forth between the violence thing, especially when you consider the origin of America, right? How was this country founded? I mean, you can pick any story you want. It's all violent. It's all violence, right? And so that's where my, you know, as a human being, as a black man, I go back and forth between that issue of, you know, what would I do in that situation? Because my instinct is not nonviolent if you attack me. That's not my instinct, right? That's why I recognize the incredible strength that it took for Dr. King. That's why I say he wasn't soft at all. It's incredibly, you know, gangster's not the right word either. Prophetic. Right? So yeah. So those are some of the things that I feel like continuation of, and then some of the things that I feel like not so sure of. Excellent question. Yes.
I'm a visiting student from Sweden. And
how about that? How you doing? That's cool. I bet nobody guesses that.
No. Every
you
time.
Go under the radar. You got to use that.
But when I got here, I've only been here for a semester, I was in shock of how segregated it is. I've only been like around in Philly and gone around, but I've been in West Philly and here in Villanova, and it's very evident how segregation is still very prominent in this country, just looking at our area. And from what I've realized, people go to schools where they live. So I understand, like, from as an artist, you're trying to influence people with your art. But as a professor, do you think that the education system, university, schools, teachers are doing their very best to, like, make people open their eyes, as you said in your speech?
Yeah, that's a great question. Do I think they're all doing their best? No. But, you know, there's definitely institutions and professors and, you know, administrators who are dedicated to it. I think, you know, I teach at a school called Morgan State University, which is a HBCU. Do you know about the HBCUs? Yeah, so, and again, they weren't created because black people were like, hey, we want to just be by ourselves and study together. You know what I'm saying? They were created because, you know, we lived in America and we couldn't go to, tell me about the history of Villanova. What year? 1842. And when was the first African-American student in Villanova? See what I mean? So that's why we had to create HBCUs. So even that's a result of, I mean, you see it as segregated, but it's also like, it's segregated because we couldn't go to, you know, Villanova necessarily or some other school. So it was like kind of forced. So that's one interesting thing. I mean, I try to do it in my classes, open people's eyes, you know, do it. But I think on an institutional level, it's probably not happening. But I'm here, so this is a good start. This is a good way to start the year off. You know? Yeah. Okay, now hold on. Before you say anything, this is like, for all the, if you're a black person, you know how this feels, right? When you speak as a black person, a lot of times, especially if you're a PWI, predominantly white institution, you're like expected to speak for the whole race. You know what I'm saying? Like, whatever you say is so, here's the first, so this is going to be like, yo, everyone's looking at you, man. Like, you're representing the whole race right now.
I mean, I'm good friends with Devon, so, like, he got me good on this. You know, like, don't make that happen. But you talked a lot about the incarceration system, and I know that statistics show that I think 49% of black males are incarcerated before the age of 23. I've seen that statistic. But my point is, in making that observation about the incarceration system and everything that's wrong, what, in your opinion, is something we can do to fulfill the obligation to make something happen and make a change?
Cool. Great question. I mean, there's a lot of things you could do. First of all, educate yourself, awareness. So that's the first step, educate yourself, awareness. There's lots of great books on it, lots of great information out there on it. So that's one thing. There's also a ton of different organizations working to eradicate it, working to bring justice to it, working to create, to undo some of the disparity. Like, I'll give you an example of disparity. So 5 grams of crack, federal sentencing. 5 grams of crack gets you 5 years in jail. How many grams of coke? Coke and crack are pharmacologically the same, right? How many grams of cocaine? But only difference between coke and crack, we know the difference, right? There's cocaine in this area. And when I say this area, I'm not just talking about Villanova, I'm talking about Main Line. See, you know, this is where it's at. But crack is in North Philly, right? In the hood, you know what I'm saying? So that's the only difference between crack and coke. It's just who does it, right? And pharmacologically, they're the same. Who does it is different. White, I went to Lafayette College. That was my first time around a large group of white people. And I was coming from uptown Philly, North Philly. And, you know, you hear so many stereotypes. But when I got to college, I said, I've never seen so many drugs and shit in my life. The things that these kids are doing here at Lafayette College, if we were doing that in North Philly, the whole block would be in jail. I mean, it just wouldn't even happen. You know, these kids were way more egregious in the things that they were doing than any kid that I was in juvie with, or, you know what I'm saying? These kids were, but they had privilege. Privilege of skin, privilege of wealth, whatever, right? And so it's different. So anyway, go back to this thing about pharmacologically saying crack, coke. 5 grams of crack get you 5 years in prison. How many grams of cocaine would it take you to get 5 years in prison? Federally, yeah. 500. It's a big difference. Where my math people at? Yeah. So that's my thing. So you're asking how can you, look, man, you got the internet, dude. Go online, sign some petition, get involved, join some organizations. I know there's a social justice club here, Department of Justice and Peace, get involved, you know what I mean? Make it a point to be involved. Make it a point to get involved and work in the prisons. There's a bunch of programs that you can go to prisons. A professor was just telling me about it. Who was the Greater Fur professor? Okay, yeah. You know, get involved with the, you know, talk to them about how you can get involved. And, you know, but you just got to be active, and you got to want to do something about it. I think that's important. You know, and like I said, remember, the person who made that law, and, you know, that person didn't come from the black community. That person didn't come from jail. That person came from the main line or something. I don't know. So it's also about educating your community, your family, your friends, and your social network. You know what I mean? That's really important. Again, it's not just about going into the hood. It's about where you at and who are you around and how do they think, and educating them. That's the hard work. Going into the hood, that's not the hard. The hard work is your people, if you know what I mean. yes, and then we'll go yes.
The mic's over here, so.
Oh, okay,
sorry about
cool.
That. So.
That's called a veto.
My question is, what advice can you give to students who want to provoke change, but are held back by a university that gives into the politics of fear?
Ooh. Well, I mean, I automatically think of a old school song. What is it? Can't nobody hold me down. Oh, no. You know, you can't let anybody stop you or hold you back. How can a university hold you back? What can they do? Yeah.
So it seems as if not many people are involved with the very few protests that we do. It doesn't seem as if it's promoted, things like that.
Oh, but you got to do that.
And I have.
Yeah, okay, that's what I'm saying. You got to continue to, and you can't, you know, this is the thing. I'm at a university, and I love my university, but I also recognize what my university is. My university is a corporation, and pretty much all universities in America are corporations. So I don't expect them to do what you're talking about you want to do. The students have to do that, point blank, period. And you probably will get no, if you get any support from the university, that's wonderful. But don't expect it. Don't count on it. That's not what this set up to do, necessarily, unless you get a radical educator or radical administrator or radical, but that's, you know, I would, you know, that's what struggle is. That's what struggle is. It's nobody's coming to these things. The university's not supporting it, but you have to find a way to mobilize and organize and get students energized. That's why they call it struggle. Real talk. That's why they call it struggle. It's Dr. King, everyone had to deal with this. People not coming out. People not showing up. Nobody giving support, even though the causes are you know. And you also have to make the university care. The university, think about it, is like a corporation. If Coca-Cola has some offensive ad on, they don't care unless they're pressured, and then they have to care. So make them care. You know, and that's, you know, and you have to do that in whatever way that you come up with. Use your imagination, but that's what you have to do. Same thing with politicians, right? They don't care until they gotta care, until it looks bad. You know? So Villanova doesn't want to look bad. Nobody wants to look bad. But make them care. Put pressure. Apply pressure. You know? Father Peter looking at me like. He's like, oh, man. next week's going to be rough. You know? But, yeah. So what else? Oh, yep.
If I could just add for everyone's sake, a couple more questions we'll take. So MK is also going to do book signing in the back. So make yourself known if you want to ask a question now.
Yeah, I'm going to do book signing in the back. You can also follow me at MK Asante, mkasante.com for those who, yeah.
Hi, first, thank you so much for your talk. It was good. I guess I should stand up. But one of the things that struck me when you were talking is you said Oscar Michaud, am I pronouncing that right? He wouldn't just tweet about it. And I know that's like a big thing that a lot of like my friends do and like students here do. Like the most recent example I can think of is like University of Mizzou. So a lot of people are like, I stand with you. But I remember talking to a friend and one time she's like, a lot of people can like usually post about it, but then like you forget about it later. And it's not necessarily because students like, it's not that they don't want to get involved. It's just that they're not sure what more they can do like hundreds of miles away from like where a problem is actually happening. So like, do you have any sort of suggestions of how someone can get involved, like even like so far, like Villanova versus University of Missouri, kind of like the distance?
Yeah, versus in terms of what?
Not, sorry, it's probably the wrong word, but more okay. Just like across that long distance where it's not like you can physically go attend the protest. Or
yeah,
like
and that. By the way, that was a great, I mean, that whole Mizzou thing, thank you for your question, but that whole Mizzou thing was a kind of an illustration of what I was saying about universities being corporations, and you know, at the end of the day, you know, I mean, they make corporate decisions. You know what I'm saying? Especially if it's economic, you know. And so the players there recognize their power, and I think a lot of times players and students are made to feel powerless, but you actually have a lot of power, and so I mean, you are the power essentially. Without you, there's no school. You know what I'm saying? So students are very powerful. And as far as like the Twitter thing, I was saying Twitter thing. I actually think social media is a good thing to do. Like, this is a good. So I wasn't like knocking Twitter fingers. You know what I'm saying? But I was just saying that that can't be like where it stops. You know what I'm saying? So definitely using social media is powerful, and there's a lot of times where it's worked in terms of getting certain things passed or getting raising awareness. So I like social media, and I think it's a good tool. I just think it can't stop there, you know? Find a way to get involved beyond just social media, you know? I think that's the message. That's what I was kind of telling to him. Find a way to get involved beyond social media. You know, there's lots of organizations, and that's the thing. I mean, you know, Dr. King, remember, you know, the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, there's a whole bunch of, there was SLIC, SNCC, there's all these different organizations when we think of civil rights movement. They were organized. They were organizations to be involved in. I think that's important. So check it out.
All right. Hi.
Hey.
So, hi, everyone. So in Buck, you talk about how your name means prince in Zulu. I think the Zulus kind of like epitomize the power of language because every name has a specific meaning. So I guess my question is, in terms of like your own identity being labeled as like Black Buck, Slave Buck, versus like taking on the identity of like Malo and like Young Buck, like how is that kind of like at different parts of your life, I guess, kind of shaped your identity?
Well, I think the newest part, because she's right, she's talking about my name and all these things, and the newest part is MK, because now I go by MK.
Yeah.
And there's a story behind that. You know, like I said, Malo means bad in Spanish, and I used to like that. You know, Puerto Rican girls be like, you know your name means bad in Spanish? Like, yeah. I know. I thought that was cool when I was a teenager, but you know, as I got older, I embraced the term prince, you know, because it means prince. But then as I got even older, what happened was I went back to Zimbabwe. Nelson Mandela created a military wing of the ANC, right? The ANC was the African National Congress, freedom fighting organization in South Africa. So he created a military wing of the ANC called Mkhonto we Sizwe, right? And when I went back to Zimbabwe for the first time since I was born there, I hooked up with the old Mkhonto we Sizwe soldiers. Now, they don't call them Mkhonto we Sizwe soldiers. They call them soldiers of the MK, because the MK is the short name for Mkhonto we Sizwe, and MK means spear of a nation. And so when I went back to Zimbabwe, they started calling me MK. It's my initials anyway. But they were just referring to me as, they said I was a spear of a nation. And so MK is the latest. You asked about these names. I'm kind of like, you know, the professor version of Diddy, I guess. Like, you know how he Puff Daddy, and then it was Diddy, and then it was Sean Combs. That's kind of what I'm going through. You know what I'm saying? So I'm at my MK phase where just MK, come see me next year. Probably be some, just call me. I don't even have a name. Just, you hear that and you know it's me. Thank y'all so much. I'm going to be signing books back.